Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Good to see you, One Life Church. Sunday morning, always good. I'm privileged and honored to be here. It's been a wonderful weekend. I've had an excellent time. I've been freezing my tail off most of the weekend, but no, that's not true. It's not true. I've enjoyed the snow and the cold, but 4 days is all that anyone needs. And then, I really have really, really loved everything about this weekend. I've loved getting to meet new people and fellowship with believers that we didn't know before, but we'll never forget, and forge new relationships. And thank you for the free course for the Word has been spectacular, both in this room and then when we did the men's breakfast yesterday, and then I watched Mark last night flow in that river of free course for the Word and enjoyed the Word immensely. What a spectacular visual example of the Father's heart. When I see Mark and Valerie, you bless me. And thank you for being you and who you are. And I appreciate them so much, and I honor what they do and what they're doing. And thank you to Peter and Kathy for having me in. It is an honor to fill anyone's pulpit, especially people that you love and respect and know are doing a great work for the kingdom, and I believe that very much. And so I honor that, and I thank you. I have a couple of things to say, sort of. I hate to use dispense of or get out of the way, but Sunday morning I try to do a little more background and bio for people before we get into the Word. I do come to you from Flowery Branch, Georgia. That's about 45 miles or so northeast of Atlanta. And my wife, Natasha, sends her blessings and her greetings. We are not at a place yet where she can travel with me all of the time. We still have one kid at home that can't drive yet, and so she's still in school, and so she needs mom around. That's my daughter Lauren. She's 15. She's a sophomore in high school, and I have a son, Lucas, who is 19. He's a sophomore in college. He goes to Doane University in Nebraska, right outside of Lincoln, and he's home. He got home last night for Christmas, so I have extra incentive to get back home and see my son, who's home for a month. That's going to be exciting times, good times. This is my last trip of the year, at least my last ministry trip of the year, and so it's exciting to get back home and see them and hang with them. They send their best and their blessings and their love. Also, I do have product. I'm not a real good salesman. I don't do marketing very well. Peter did a plenty good job on the books. Avail yourself of them. I think they'll bless you heart and soul, and blood, sweat, and tears went into them. And they are a picture of where we were on the journey and where we are on the journey in this message. Also, I think I have a couple CD sets left of the whole armor of God. I brought a few old, not very many people use CDs any longer, but I still have CD sets that we produced over the years. Have a couple of the whole armor of God. That's the Paul's whole armor of God message from a grace perspective. And so there's a couple of those left. And all that's $10 a piece. There are some flash drives on that table. We ask $50 a piece for those. They are full of sermons. The blue flash drive is all of my travel sermons from 2018. We'll be preparing a new flash drive in a couple of weeks for all of my travel sermons for 2019. But I have all of last year on that table. Wherever we went, like Minneapolis, and did a weekend, we put those sermons up on the every Sunday. I put a new sermon up on our YouTube page. It goes to our website, and they're from all over the world. And so that flash drive has about 75 sermons on it. And then the red flash drive is the book of Hebrews. I taught the book of Hebrews verse by verse when we were in our pastorate in Missouri. We took 43 sermons to walk through that book. So that is, and I am now taking that series and writing a set of sort of layman's commentaries on the book of Hebrews. We're working that up with study guides and all of that. That will be my goal for 2020, is to publish that on the book of Hebrews. And so that's what we're building off of, is on that flash drive. And so if you'd like to partner with our ministry, we would take you. The application process is very flimsy. We have 100% approval rate. Your credit doesn't matter. Your past payment history doesn't matter. You want to partner with us, we'll take whatever you can give whenever you can give it. So you can take months off. Where are you going to get that kind of deal? And you can still listen to the stuff. We won't even send you a bill or with interest. But honestly, because of partners, we get to do what we do full time. And we produce a daily podcast. So we put out 9 audio releases a week on our podcast. We've had about 3.5 million audio downloads of our material. We put 2 new videos up every week on YouTube. We put our midweek Bible study from Georgia, and we put our travels from the road, and we don't charge anything for that stuff. So you get to listen to that, whether you partner with us or not. That's available. That's free. It was very important to me to get bread on the table that didn't cost a dime for people. When I came into the message of grace, I couldn't find anything that didn't have a paywall in front of it. You know, I wanted to hear something. This was the days everybody was trying to make a buck off the internet. And I'd want to hear a message, and there was a paywall. You need to pay $5 to hear this sermon. And I said, Lord, you ever give me the opportunity to minister this grace, I'm going to give it out as much as I can give it out and still make it. And so we give it out for free as much as possible. We have a small amount of items for sale. Most of it's right there on that table. But 99.9% of everything we do, you can listen to for nothing or watch for nothing. So if that's important to you and you want to see other people do that, consider partnering with us. $5 a month, $10 a month, $20 a month, doesn't sound like much. But a bunch of people do it. It goes a long, long way. And if you can do that, you can sign up on my website, paulwhiteministries.com, and just partner with us. And we appreciate it. And again, if you don't ever do that, be blessed by the Word. The Word is what works. And I'm an advocate of that. Let me say a word to this church before a minister. You're a year old as a body. As individuals, you bring a whole life to the table. You bring every room you've ever walked in into the room you just walked into. Every experience you've ever had. You're immensely stronger as a group than you are as individuals. As a body of believers, you have an unbelievable amount of potential. You were not designed to do this alone. You were designed to do this in groups. Part of the word we're going to share this morning deals with that, but Pastor Peter told me about the journeys he's looking forward to in next year in 2020 about new wine and new wineskins, taking new wine and not wasting it in an old wineskin. And I like his honesty. It's my honesty as well, is that I don't really know what that looks like. I don't know what the new wineskin is supposed to look like. But I think that the reason why it's so hard to pin down what it's supposed to look like is because it's not supposed to look the same in every place. I hear a lot of people say to me, I wish the church would turn into the church of the book of Acts. I think the church needs to be more like the book of Acts. And my response to them is, which part of the book of Acts do you prefer? Do you want to be the church of the book of Acts? That is Acts chapter 2, where only a certain bloodline gets in. Do you want to be the church of Acts chapter 4 that experiments with socialism, where everybody sells all their goods and puts them in a big pile and then we take what we need? Do you want to be the church of Acts 5, that if you come in and you do something wrong, you fall over and die? We can keep doing this all the way through the book of Acts. I don't want to preach on that this morning, but my point is the church of the book of Acts was figuring it out as they went. And we get this idea that they had it figured out if we could just do it like they did it. We are doing it like they did it, in that we are adjusting and we are growing and we are adjusting to the culture and to the time and to the place and to the people. So the new wineskin, the problem with the old wineskin is it's solid and rigid, but the problem is we can't identify what new wineskins look like because they're fresh and they're new and they're pliable and they're adjustable and they don't crack because they don't have room to move to the left or the right. They adjust with the moment, they adjust with the room, they adjust with the culture, and they adjust with the time. So the new wineskin, you won't get it figured out. But until you're ready to get rid of the old one, you're not ready to embrace the new one. So there's a lot to lay aside in the new year, and there's a lot to embrace, and just step forward patiently and slowly. That's my encouragement. And don't be afraid to expand and adjust. That's part of being the church of the book of Acts. It's not having it all figured out. It's allowing the Holy Spirit to adjust. All right, are you ready for the Word today? Yes. Kind of feels like we've already started, actually, on the Word today, but I do have something that the Father's put in my heart for you today, and I want to build a little bit off of what we talked about on Friday. I know that's risky because not everybody is here on Friday, and you don't want to spend all of your time rehashing and getting people up to speed. I'll give you the one or two sentence version. You can know God as God, or you can know God as Father. Yes. If you know God as God, He's a Creator God, and you're likely to believe that because you don't see Him, He's not there. And since He's not there, it might lead you down the road to believing that He doesn't exist at all, or at least He doesn't care about you. And the best version you have is He's out there, but He's mad. That's why things are going wrong. Once you see Jesus on the cross, God displayed His love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Once you get a demonstration of the love of God at Calvary, you start to have the potential to call yourself a son. And if you can call yourself a son, you must have a dad. And you start to see God not as a creator, but as a father. And the moment you start to see God as a father, you start to dispense of the God of wrath and judgment, because you realize bad stuff isn't happening to you because God's mad at you. Bad stuff's happening to you because you're human, and that you have a Father who walks through the valley of the shadow of death with you, and that helps to face whatever crises you face on the planet, because you don't just have a God, you have a dad, and a dad's a big deal, and it's a father, not just a father figure, but a father in who we are. So what we really ended with Friday was helping you to see God as your Father through the cross. God becomes man in the body of Christ, the body of Jesus. Jesus lives this life to perfection. Jesus takes sin, judgment, and death into Himself at the cross. Jesus raises from the dead. We get to see God as Father because we get to see Jesus as Son. No man comes unto the Father but by Me. And so as we come in through Jesus, we get to see Him as Father. But I don't want to leave you with the impression that the cross was God's way of adjusting to the fact that we saw Him as Creator, and that He jumps in and decides to let you know, no, I'm not just Creator, I'm Father. I don't believe God makes an adjustment at Calvary. I believe the heart of God was always for us to see Him as Father, but it takes growing into that understanding, and then Jesus sort of accelerates that when He comes and shows us what the Father looks like. But I don't want to be left with the assumption that God makes some sort of cosmic adjustment. He's trying to get through to us. That doesn't work well, so He goes, okay, I'm going to come and become one of them. Because sometimes we sort of present Jesus' incarnation as God's last-ditch effort. You know, it's like the law didn't work and the prophets didn't get them to change and they didn't come around through the Psalms and the Proverbs. Now what we'll do is I'll go down there and be one of them. And I don't believe that was God at all. I don't believe that His response mechanism to us missing Him is Jesus. I think Jesus is the plan all along. Jesus is the end game of God from the time the game started. He didn't adjust in the fourth quarter and then throw in Jesus. He had the idea the entire time, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this in a way in which relationship trumps all other things. How do we know that this is the heart of God? I think we can find it in the book of Genesis. I think right out of the gate, I think the first three chapters of your Bible are probably the most important three chapters of your Bible in laying out the design and heart of God. I'm not going to preach the first three chapters of Genesis today. I want to take a few moments out of them, particularly from chapter 1, a little bit from chapter 2. So meet me in Genesis 1, and I want to do a little bit of work from the garden and the creation story, and I want to show you what I believe is God's method of teaching us about His love and about relational love and familial love, and it runs deep through the thread of the Bible all the way back into the story of creation. Genesis chapter 1, let's start in verse 20 today. God said, "Let the waters abound with an abundance of living creatures," or souls, "and let birds fly above the earth across the face of the firmament of the heavens." So God created great sea creatures and every living thing that moves, with which the waters abounded according to their kind, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And God blessed them and said, "Be fruitful and multiply, fill the waters in the seas, and let birds multiply on the earth." And the evening and the morning were the fifth day. So the creative narrative has the fifth day being God speaking into existence the animals of the land, the great sea creatures, every living thing that moves, every winged bird. This happens on day number five. Then God said, "Let the earth bring forth the living creature according to its kind, cattle and creeping thing and beast of the earth, each according to its kind." And it was so. And God made the beast of the earth according to its kind, cattle according to its kind, and everything that creeps on the earth according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. Notice that what God saw on day five was that it was good, and what God sees now as we introduce day six is God sees that it is good. And what has God done? He spoke to the water and produced fish. He spoke to the sky and produced birds. He spoke to the ground and produced animals. No gender specific, just creatures after their kind. They are a collective, a group of dogs, a group of zebras, a group of fish, a group of birds. They are not individuals. They are classifications. They are birds. They are fish. They are animals. And then God said, "Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. So what does God do now? He no longer looks into the sky to pull out birds, or the water to pull out fish, or the land to pull out water. He looks into himself. And God said to himself, "Let us create man in our own image." And from himself, he pulls man. Animals from dirt, fish from water, birds from sky, but man from God. And the only place for man on the food chain is then at the highest spot, because God says, "Let him have dominion over every other thing," because every other thing was pulled out of something else, but man was pulled out of me. And whereas I brought other things out of the earth as collectives, each after his kind, I don't bring man out after his kind. He doesn't have a relative on the earth. He doesn't have anything that is his kind on the planet. Instead, he has to be from outside of the planet. I have to take a piece of heaven and deposit it and mix it with a piece of the earth. This is why when man's story gets fleshed out, he gets fashioned out of dirt and the spirit of heaven gets breathed into his lungs. So his heart begins to beat from another dimension. He literally carries the spirit of his creator inside of a flesh suit. He is what his father looks like on the earth. That's man, and he's designated in the creative narrative as male and female. Birds, fish, animals, after their kind. Man, male and female. And yet there's no specific breakdown of Eve in this story yet. All we have at this point is the genders, male and female. God blesses them. 28 says to them, "Be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, have dominion over the fish of the sea, birds of the air, every living thing that moves on the earth." God said, "See, I've given you every herb that yields seed which is on the face of the earth, every tree whose fruit yields seed, to you it shall be for food, to every beast, to every bird, to everything that creeps. Wherever there's life, I gave it green herb for food, and it was so." And God saw everything he had made, and indeed it was very good. So the evening and the morning were the sixth day. Notice that when God creates everything else in the creative narrative, it is good. When God gets to man, it is very good. Why does God step it up a notch? Because when he creates man, he puts a piece of himself in the earth. So the earth itself is good, but the image of God is very good. So God makes the world after its kind, nothing unique. God makes man after himself completely unique, containing within man both male and female. That tells me something about God, that God contains within himself all of the qualities and characteristics of both male and female. How can he not? He's God, and we're from him. That never gets an overwhelming response in Christian churches. I don't know why we struggle with the idea that both male and female came out of God. I think we've made God a man for so long, and even though the Bible specifically says he's not one, he's not a man, but inside of God he holds the qualities of everything about what it means to be human. And so a lot of our struggles come from not understanding that everything about what it means to be human we received from the image of our Father, the image of who he is. And so he says in Genesis 1 that out of himself he makes male and female, and that it was very good. But we miss in the Genesis 1 narrative a very important key moment in the story. The narrative of Genesis is interesting. Genesis 1 gives a smattering of the first 6 days. Genesis 2 introduces you to the seventh day of rest and then starts over. It's odd. It doesn't start all the way at the beginning. It doesn't go back to Genesis. It doesn't go back to 1-1 in the beginning, but it goes back to the beginning of day 6. Genesis narrative lays out day 1, day 2, day 3, day 4, day 5, day 6, end of chapter, day 7, day 6. It's an interesting move that the writer makes. And the purpose of this is to show us some things that happened in detail in the middle of that sixth day. Most of chapter 2 takes the narrative backwards to that sixth day to show you an incident in which verse 18 of chapter 2, the Lord God said, "It is not good that man should be alone. I'll make him a helper comparable to him." And I introduced to you the first moment in the Bible where God said something was not good. Genesis days 1 through 5, God said it's good. Day 6, God saw man and said it's very good. But in the middle of day 6, "and the Lord God said," actually in the Hebrew, there's a past tense word between God and said. The Lord God had said. So Genesis 2 is looking back into a moment in the middle of day 6 in which God looks at his very good man and says, "It's not good to leave man by himself. It's not good for man to be alone." So the Bible's first instance of not good is you in isolation. So the heart of God is that it's a bad place for man to be left in isolation. The first place where God says not good is when he looks at man alone and says, "We can do better than this. I can't leave man on the planet alone." Not only is man unable to reproduce himself by himself, but Adam has inside of him the very nature of his creator. Remember, Genesis 1 said he created him male and female. He created them. But inside of God was Adam, and inside of Adam is Eve. And so all that needs to be done is to separate or parse out the part of Adam that completes Adam in another body. And so that's what God does. He takes from Adam's side woman, and Adam says, "At last I see myself." That's basically what he says in the Hebrew. "At last I see myself standing in front of me." And he names her Eve. She's woman. And that, but without her, this is what fascinates me. Without her presence, God said it's not good. It's not good for man to be alone. It tells me a couple things. First of all, it's not good for you to be alone in this journey. There are no loners in Christianity. The thing that God is doing is fashioning a body, not a solo artist. And so God is always bringing us into community because you're better as a unit than you are as an individual. It doesn't mean that you're not saved without other people. Your redemption is not a work of the body. Your redemption is a work of his body. The body of Christ is what, his body is what redeemed you. He said, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you. Take, drink, this is my blood of a new covenant shed for you." So Christ is the reason why we are righteous, and Christ is the reason why we are redeemed. But together as a body, we find absolution, we find completion, we find the ability to do what we can't do on our own. It also tells me that God celebrates relationship. While celebrating individuality, he celebrates relationship within individuality. What I mean by celebrating individuality, when he made birds, he made them after their kind. When he made animals, he made them after their kind. When he made fish, he made them after their kind. When he made man, he made him after himself. And he made him an individual, so much so he gave him a name. He didn't name the tigers and the lions and the bears, but he named the man. He let man name the animals because man had dominion over them. But God named the man because God gave him individuality. He let him be an individual in the universe. He let him make his own decisions. He even gives him the opportunity by going, I'm going to put all these trees in front of you and here's one I don't want you to eat. And we go, why would God put a tree in front of us we're not supposed to eat if he knows that a bunch of bad stuff happens if we eat it? Because you're nothing in this world if you don't learn how to say no to the wrong tree. And the book of Genesis is not God putting man in a garden where he can't fail. The book of Genesis is God showing his love by putting you in a garden where you can fail. Because only in a garden where you can fail can you walk out victorious, knowing that you are a man on the earth who has the ability to overcome evil. So most of us in Christianity think, boy, if I could, we just get to a utopia where there's no temptation any longer. You'd be worthless on the earth if you never had a struggle. You were worthless on the earth if you never had an issue, if you never had a problem. I'm going down a road right here I really didn't intend to go down, so there's a reason. So I'm just going to trust the Holy Spirit to go down it for a second, all right? Peter gave me extra time today to go. I think that until we realize that there's a snake in the garden and there's a tree in the garden, that's a problem, and that the issue is not that the devil snuck in there to ruin what God did, but that God always is aware of what's going on in our garden and wants us strengthened to be able to overcome it. Ought to tell us that we are a people who could face adversity and persecution and trial and tribulation and not feel as if it's judgment from God, but feel as if it's an opportunity to show off God on the earth. Yes. In the face of trial. This is why the early church said, we count it all joy when we walk into divers temptations. Why'd the early church mean that? Well, what we've learned is we get better when we get better. When we face adversity, we get a little better, which makes us better. We end up being a better people when we get better in the midst of our adversity. But until I have adversity, I don't get better. And if I don't get better, I don't get better. And I remain what I am, and I might even go backwards. That's why Jesus, I think I mentioned this a little bit to the men's breakfast yesterday, but Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane. Garden of Gethsemane is the place of the oil press. It's the olive press. It's where you get the life squeezed out of you. And that's what he's doing. He's going to the cross, and the life is being squeezed out of him before he gets there. And his response is he sweats great drops of blood in the garden on his way to the cross. But he prays to the Father and says, Dad, if there's a way for us to do this any other way except going to the cross, let's choose that way. There's Jesus' humanity coming out. And I've read that text many times and thought, oh, what would happen if he says, no, I don't want to go to the cross. Well, he doesn't have to. He's God on the earth. Well, he said, they can't take my life. I have to lay it down freely. They can't just take him to the cross. He has to go to the cross. He holds the cup of judgment in front of him and says, Father, I'll drink this, but I don't want to. But I will, if that's what you want me to do. And he's being pressed and squeezed in the hour of maximum danger. And he says yes to that cross so that we get to say amen to who he is. But have you ever imagined if he had said no? And that's the journey I've been wrestling with. What would happen if Jesus said no? And the Holy Spirit began to speak to me and say, it's impossible that he had said no, because he'd already walked down into the wilderness. He comes out of the River Jordan. This is my beloved Son, whom I am well pleased. And the Holy Spirit descends in the form of a dove. And the Bible says, and Jesus went down into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. Who led him into the wilderness? Led of the Holy Spirit to be tempted of the devil. The Holy Spirit walked, anointed, called Son of God Jesus into the wilderness to face the greatest dragon he would ever face. A dragon that offered him the opportunity to skip the cross and have the world. Right? What's the devil say to him in the wilderness? If you'll bow down, I'll give you everything. You can skip all of this and I'll give it to you. The opportunity to get it all without paying the price, and Jesus overcomes the enemy in the wilderness by saying that he is a son. if you be a son, do this. I am a son. I don't have to do this. And that equipment facing the enemy in that wilderness equips Jesus to walk into the Garden of Gethsemane and say yes to the ultimate temptation to avoid the cross, because he's already faced off once and he's equipped. Listen, don't look at your trials and your tribulations and your persecutions and your problems and your tests as evidence that God's mad or that he's left you. Use it as evidence that there's a Gethsemane on the way and this is your training ground. And that if you will count it joy, you can face off with whatever you walk into the wilderness to face off with, because God designed you to overcome.
Amen.
He doesn't put a tree in the garden if Adam's not capable of overcoming. That's a God that loves you. I know we struggle with trying to wrap our minds around how that's a loving God. That's a parent that refuses to be a helicopter parent. That's a parent that says, I'm going to let them skin their knee. Well, you can't let them ride that bike because what if they get hurt? They go, no, they need to get hurt. That'll teach them not to wreck the bike, right? They need to have some problems. That'll teach them how to overcome problems. They need to learn how to do this because that'll teach them how they need to do the next task. And that's a love that's another dimension love. And so God, it's not good for my man to be alone, gives him Eve, and out of that becomes this relationship. Because, and here's why I believe God does that. Because God wants man to see the need for relational love. That the way to relate to God is through family. And the way to relate through God is to relationship. And to understand that we are the byproduct of something else. So God is showing off what he wants to do. Sneak down to 24. Genesis 2:24. Therefore, this is right after the first marriage ceremony of the Bible. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. Now, I find it very interesting that two chapters into the Bible, God gives you the creation story and the end game of the Bible, and you're not out of chapter 2. Creation story, I bring man out of myself, I bring woman out of man. End game, I put woman and man back together and make them one flesh. The entire story of the Bible is God putting himself into the earth and then chasing man down with love, with affection. We have sidetracks. We get lost in the law. We get lost in the wilderness. We get lost in sin. But it's a journey of chasing us down so that he can ultimately create in himself one flesh. Because the story of the new covenant is that's where we're heading. That's the road that we're on. So Jesus comes in to be a representative of the new man in the earth. Remember when the Apostle Paul says this, there was a first Adam and there was a last Adam. What's that mean? There's no second Adam in the Bible. We don't get a recreated Adam in the Bible. So who's the last Adam? Paul presents it as Jesus, the resurrected man on the earth. What does he mean? God creates a man from dust and puts his spirit in him. God recreates a man from dust and puts his spirit in him at a place called the resurrection. Jesus, who enters the earth through the first Adam, leaves the earth as the last Adam. He has to enter the earth in humanity, born of a woman, born under the law, first Adam, so that he can resurrect and ascend and then sit inside of our hearts on the throne of his Father, at the right hand of his Father in the majesties, as the last Adam. God's last example of a man on the earth. Think of it this way. The Bible, if you wanted to sum it down as tight as possible, is the story of two men on the earth. One man named Adam, who is created in the image of God and fails, and God woos him for the entire Bible. Becomes him near the end of the Bible in the form of Jesus, and then dies as him at a place called the cross. 2 Corinthians 5, Paul says, we thus conclude, if one man died, all men died. So at Calvary, Jesus goes to the cross as humanity so that he can resurrect as a new man on the earth. So that when you come to Christ, you can come into a new man rather than being bound to an old man. So the Bible's a story of two men in the earth. The first Adam and the last Adam. Not, by the way, the first Adam and the second Adam. the first Adam and the last Adam. God's done recreating himself on the earth. All recreation comes through the man, Christ Jesus. So Jesus comes to encapsulate the creative process of the Father. John caught that, by the way, the author of the Gospel of John. How does Genesis start? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, darkness on the face of the deep. How's John 1:1 start? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. What's John doing? He's rewriting the Genesis narrative with Jesus as Adam. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. There's no Adam in the story brought out of the ground. There's an Adam in the story brought out of the heavens. Christ coming down, wrapped in flesh, to become a new man on the earth. And for as many of us as believe in his name, he hath given us the authority to call ourselves what? Sons of God. In other words, he jams you into the first two chapters of Genesis right there in John chapter 1. He says, for as many of us as believe in Jesus, we get the right to be the recreated man on the earth. We get the right to express the image of the Father through a new covenant reality on the planet. Look at John chapter 14. I want to take us to Jesus, and then I want to walk us to how the Apostle Paul handles this. John chapter 14. Verse number 19, I dealt with John 14 a little bit on Friday in talking about let not your heart be troubled and talking about the way, the truth, and the life. And I feel like even up till this point this morning, all I've really done in this message is sort of lead you up to where we really want to get started, and that's with Jesus. Jesus is the author and finisher of our faith. He's always where I like to start and stop sermons. So everything that we just did leads you up to the real beginning where Jesus comes on the scene, because Jesus in his narrative tells you what he's here to do. John 14, 19 says, a little while longer, and the world will see me no more, but you will see me, because I live, you will live also. At that day, you'll know that I'm in the Father, and you're in me, and I'm in you. I'll deal with 20 in a moment, but I want to take a glance for a second at 19, where Jesus says, a little while longer, and the world will see me no more, but you will see me. Because I live, you will live also. How is it that the world will not see him, but his disciples will see him? It's easy for us to say, well, that's because of the resurrection. They'll get to see him, but the world won't get to see him. But Jesus doesn't talk to them in natural terms, because in verse 20, he says, at that day, you'll know that I'm in the Father, and you're in me, and I'm in you. So Jesus isn't talking about, you're going to know I've resurrected because you see me with your eyeballs. Jesus says, you're going to know I'm resurrected because you sense that I live in your heart. And when you sense that I live in your heart, the Father is in me, I'm in the Father, and both the Father and I live in you, you're going to realize that the Father's end game was to come back into the residence of who you are. So think of it in these terms. God pulls man from himself. Inside of man is male and female. So God reaches inside of man and pulls out woman. God tells us that marriage is the reuniting of that man and that woman into one flesh. That one flesh is then encouraged on the earth to reproduce. That one flesh fails at the tree of the knowledge of good and evil and gains consciousness of good and evil. There's another split. That consciousness runs man out of the garden where he gets a perceived separation from God. He doesn't feel like he can ever be on par with God or one with God any longer. Start over in John. Recreate on the earth. Jesus comes as a new Adam. Jesus sacrifices himself at Calvary, and out of his side, blood and water flows, and the church is born at Calvary, because that's the place where Eve was born in the garden, so the church is born at the cross, and Jesus tears down any separation, any problems that has happened on the earth that has been a void. I think when the Apostle Paul begins to grab this, his progressive theology is pretty powerful. Side note, I believe that the New Testament writers are growing in their theology the same way the Church of Acts is growing in their understanding of the Holy Spirit. And I think the faster we admit that, the better, or at least understand that, the better we'll have an understanding of what's going on in the book of Acts. Here's an example. Remember in Acts 17 when Paul goes to Athens and he speaks to the Athenian Greeks and they have a bunch of gods and they have a statue to the unknown God? And Paul goes, let me tell you about the unknown God. In him we live and move and breathe and have our being. And Paul tells them in Acts 17:26, God hath taken all of us from one blood on the earth. God has taken all of us from one man on the earth and established our boundaries and our dwellings. He has split us and separated us, and we are all groping in the dark, hoping that we can find Him, because in Him we live, move, breathe, and have our being, and we are His offspring. And he says that about a bunch of Greeks. Not a bunch of Jews, not a bunch of believers, not a bunch of Christians, a bunch of Greeks. Idol-worshipping, statue-worshipping Greeks. You're His offspring. What's He mean? He doesn't say they're sons. He says they're offspring. How do you become a son? For as many as believe on His name, He gives you the right to be called a son of God. But how are you His offspring? Because you're born of Adam. So we're all God's offspring. We're all from the first man in the earth. But the last man in the earth, Jesus, came so that we could have relationship, not just an identity of being one of His offspring, but the identity of being one of His sons. Because for God, it's important that we get past the idea of Him being our God, and that we get into the idea of being Him being our Father. And to do that, He has to bring us back from the place that we lost in the Garden of Eden. Ephesians chapter 2. Watch Paul now. Ephesians comes much later in Paul's journey. In fact, I just quoted you Acts 17, where Paul talks to the Athenians, you all from one blood. Acts 19, he goes to Ephesus for the first time, and a church is birthed. So much later in his life and ministry, he preaches to us, he writes the book of Ephesians. And in the book of Ephesians, Paul says this, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 14, "For He Himself is our peace, who has made both one and broken down the middle wall of separation, having abolished in His flesh the enmity, that is, the law of commandments contained in ordinances, so as to create in Himself," look at this text, "one new man from the two, thus making peace, and that He might reconcile them both to God in one body through the cross, thereby putting to death the enmity. He came and preached peace to you who were far off and to those who were near." There's your two categories of people. Those who are far off, called the uncircumcision, and those who are near, called the circumcision, or we like to say it this way, Gentiles and Jews. And Paul says to the church at Ephesus, Jesus came to tear down the separation between peoples, between boundaries, between groups, and create, look at the end of verse 15, one new man out of two. So the goal of Christ's cross is to make one new man out of the Jew and the Gentile. One new man on the earth under one banner. The banner is called Jesus. And to pull away any separation. So whatever separation man had when he left the garden, in which he doesn't feel he can get back in, Jesus has torn down that separation. I like to look at that separation as the great sword. Remember when Jesus, when Adam and Eve eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and the Bible says that they are Jesus sent, or God sends them out of the garden. Remember, God sends them out because He says, "I don't want them to eat from the tree of life and live forever." That's a merciful move, by the way. Why would God want you to live forever enslaved to consciousness? And so God puts a flaming sword above the way to the tree of life so that man cannot access the tree of life. The sword represents, of course, swift and sharp justice and judgment. In Matthew, Jesus says to His disciples, "Smite here, now it's time for me to go to the cross. Smite the shepherd, and the sheep will scatter." Jesus is quoting from the Old Testament. And in that Old Testament text, it actually says this, "Awake, O sword, and smite the shepherd. And when you smite the shepherd, the sheep will scatter." What sword is it that smites Jesus at the cross that needed to wake up from the Old Testament? The only sword I see in the Old Testament that fell asleep, that got lost, is a sword guarding the way to the tree of life. There's no sword in the Word that's hanging over man except for the tree of life. And that sword needs to be taken care of so that we can get to a tree to bring us life. So Jesus says to His disciples, "Smite me with that sword and the sheep will scatter." God is not a God who can judge the same thing twice. Once the sword wakes up and smites the shepherd, there's no sword left hanging over the tree of life. Calvary becomes the way back into the garden of God so that you can eat from the tree you were denied by the fall of the first Adam. The last Adam takes the sword, so you get to take the tree of life. The first moment you get a hint of it is at Calvary, when Jesus says to the criminal on the cross, who says, "Remember me when you enter your kingdom." And Jesus says, "Today you'll be with me in paradise." Paradiso is the Hebrew word for Eden. At Calvary, Jesus says to the criminal on the cross, "Today you'll be with me in Eden." And you go, "Well, maybe he meant today we're going to heaven." I don't think the Bible gets sidetracked at Calvary. I think it's had the same message since Genesis. You left, I chased you down, I put a sword over your only way of life, and now I plunge that sword into a new Adam, I plunge that sword into the first Adam for the last time. When Jesus takes judgment at the cross, he's taking the sword that guarded the way to the heart of God in the old Garden of Eden and having it plunged into himself, and his introduction to the criminal on the cross. And thank God it's to a criminal and not a Pharisee. Thank God it's to a sinner and not a saint. And to a sinner at Calvary, he looks and says, "Today I take you back into Eden, because today I introduce you to a new Adam. Today, you get to eat from the tree you haven't been able to eat from. Today, you stop being a slave to your conscience. Today, you not only physically die, today you spiritually die. And you and I will resurrect together into a new reality." What Jesus was doing was giving you access back into the garden of God, the place of provision and paradise. Jesus was making into himself one. Ephesians 5 is often called the marriage chapter. You hear marriage conferences, we quote Ephesians 5. We'll do whole classes on Ephesians 5. Nothing wrong with that, but I think we're putting the cart before the horse, because Ephesians 5 is not Paul trying to help the Ephesians understand how to make their marriages better. Ephesians 5 is the Apostle Paul trying to help the people at Ephesus understand their heavenly marriage to their spouse, Jesus. And he uses natural metaphors to describe a supernatural experience. So he gives best case scenarios of how men and women should treat one another. Not because he's trying to put his Ephesian church under performance. Like, you get done with the marriage conference and go, "Well, I'm not going to make it, because that was over my head." That's not Paul's intent. If you think Ephesians 5 is about your marriage, you're going to be condemned when you read Ephesians 5. Right. Trust me, you're not. Guys, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her. 28, husbands, love your own wives as your own body. You do that, your wife's going to leave you, because you don't treat your body very well. I mean, just straight up, you're disqualified. I mean, you treat her like you treat yourself, that marriage is doomed. Ephesians 5 is not a marriage conference on how to make your marriage better. Ephesians 5 is Paul saying, "Let me show you what a real husband and a real wife look like, and his name is Jesus." Okay? And if you'll watch him, he will treat you as the ultimate woman in the marriage, and he will treat you as the ultimate man in the marriage, and he will be to you the ultimate woman in the marriage, and he will be to you the ultimate man in the marriage. That's the point of the marriage chapter of Ephesians 5, so that you can take it and use the equipment in your own marriage, but not because it's a goal you're jumping up to, but because it's a life you're living from, because you recognize your own marriage. Now, why does the New Testament come back to the theme of marriage? Because the Old Testament started there. When God wanted to introduce relationship to man, he doesn't make man after his kind. The animals are a collective. The birds are a collective. The fish are a collective. Man's an individual. He names him. When he wants to reproduce him, he has to pull a piece of man out of man to reproduce him. He doesn't refashion woman. He pulls woman right out of man, so that when man and woman come together in marriage, now we're using a natural illustration, but it's got a supernatural application. When man and woman come together in marriage, God said they become one flesh. it's the closest possible thing to Eve and Adam going back into one, is the illustration of marriage. This is why the New Testament pitches Jesus as the husband and the church as the bride, because the bride was pulled from his side at the cross, but as we enter into intimate relationship with who he is, we come back into being one flesh in the body of Christ, and we start to know him as he is, because we become one flesh with him, and we graduate from God's just over in the glory land to Jesus lives in my heart. Most of us who come out of religion, we left a God's over there and I hope to get to him, and we entered into a relationship where Jesus lives inside of me. We are one flesh. We have become one in who he is. So start with some of these ideas in 5:25. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church. What did he do? He gave himself for her. It'll help. Let's read this again. Don't read this as a mandate for husbands what you're supposed to go home and do. Read this as instruction for what your heavenly husband does for you. Yes. If you'll do that, you'll walk away without condemnation. You'll walk away with encouragement. Husbands, love your wives the way Christ loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word. What does Christ do for his church? Sanctify and cleanse her by the washing of the water of the word. How does that happen? John chapter 13, Jesus, knowing where he was going, knowing who he was, stood up and then put an apron on and got in front of his disciples and washed their feet. And before, as he did it, he said, "You have been made clean by the words I have spoken over you." And then illustrated it by washing her feet. Paul grabs that same illustration and says, Jesus washes you off with his words. Church, the object of you coming in here is to strengthen as a body and for your pastor and your leaders to wash your feet off with the word. You don't need to get re-saved every week, but you do need to get splashed off and reminded who you are. You need splashed off of condemnation and guilt and shame, and you need reminded about who you are, and we struggle with that sometimes. So did the disciples. What did Peter say? "You're not going to wash my feet. That's nasty." Jesus goes, "You don't understand what the kingdom looks like. If I don't wash your feet, you and I don't belong together." Peter goes, "Okay, in that case, full bath." Full bath. Because if feet's good, the whole body's better. And Jesus says, "No, it's not. Any man who's already been cleaned once need not be cleaned again, save for his feet." Yeah. What's that mean? Any man who's in Christ need not be made righteous again. He need not be saved again. He need not be forgiven again. He need not be redeemed again. He needs reminded that he's saved and forgiven and redeemed and washed and pured and clean. And the reminding is the splashing off of the feet that trod through a world that doesn't care for you. They don't care for you. They don't know you. They're not out to build you up. They're not out to uplift you. And what do you get? You walk through the muck and the mire of a world who doesn't realize what kingdom you belong to. And when you come together as a collective group, what does Jesus do? He washes you. He doesn't resave you. You don't need resaved. You're already a believer. Well, what do you need? I need cleaned off of this junk. All I've heard all week is how bad I am and how miserable I am and how unforgiven I am and how worthless I am. I need someone to remind me of who I am in Christ. And how many of you realize that's the role of the Holy Spirit? Jesus said, when he comes, he will convict you of righteousness because I go to my Father and you see me no more. Why do you need to be convinced you're righteous? Because you don't see Jesus and you forgot.
Yeah.
You don't see Jesus and you forgot how righteous you are. All you see is the world and you think you're unrighteous. And you come in and you get your feet splashed off. And I tell people this all the time. If you go in and you get punched in the nose, instead of getting your feet splashed off, don't go back. You're done. Why would you go somewhere where you get punched in the nose when you were supposed to go in and get your feet cleaned off? Now you leave with your feet dirty and your nose bleeding. Now, of course, I'm talking spiritually. I mean, if that happens physically, you got a whole different problem. But if that's happening spiritually, where you come in and just get beat up and you feel like hell when you leave, you didn't see the Holy Spirit. You saw a demonic spirit.
Very true.
Doctrines of devils are here to remind you of what you are without Christ. The Holy Spirit's here to remind you of who you are in Christ. The doctrine of devil makes people's ears itch, by the way. I've had it for the last time of people going, the gospel of grace is the gospel, is the message that people with itching ears want to hear. All people with itching ears. No. Paul's the one that said that. Paul's a radical preacher of grace. grace. And Paul warns you of a day when people's ears will itch for what they heard when they were kids. And what did those Jewish Christians of the first century hear when they were kids? The law. And their ears were itching for good old-fashioned Holy Ghost preaching. That's what I come up under. I mean, good old-fashioned Holy Ghost preaching where hell is hot and heaven is sweet. And you go, man, I want to hear some of that again. And Paul said people's ears will always itch to be told how wrong they are.
Yeah.
Because they think they're wrong anyway. They think it's what they deserve. And their spirit ears itch to be told how bad they are. But I think that the message of grace is not to tell you what you were. It's to tell you who you are in Christ. And the message of one man on the earth is that there's not two men inside of you. There's not an old you and a new you going at it, punching each other all week long. Old you wins if you watch bad movies. New you wins if you fast. Old you wins if you skip church. New you wins if you tithe. Who do you think you are? You didn't need the cross. You just needed determination and willpower.
That's it.
No, you don't have that kind of determination and willpower. You needed Jesus.
Yes.
You're useless in this earth without Him. All you have is the consciousness of what's good and what's evil. Sometimes you're good enough to do the good, and sometimes you're not good enough to do the good, and you end up in the evil. It's because you had no access to a tree of life where you could sustain the reality of the life of God on the earth until you see Jesus, who had the sword plunged into Him so that you can walk freely back into the garden. That He might present her to Himself, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. Listen, the past tense has been set up in verse 25. He loved the church. Everything that happens in the next few verses, the splashing off and the presenting, is not presented to you in the future. It's presented to you as a present reality. Because Christ has loved us, He is splashing us off. He is presenting us as a glorious church. One of the deadly lies that's been bought by the church is that Jesus is working on her to someday present her to the Father as a glorious church. And the Bible doesn't say, this is a scripture you can get up and quote in almost every church in America and people amen you, and it's not scripture. But you can get up and say, Jesus is cleaning the church so that He can come back and get a glorious church without spot and wrinkle. Jesus is coming back to get a glorious church without spot and wrinkle. No, this text doesn't say anything about coming back to get a church that's someday cleaned up. The past tense has already been set in the fact that Christ loved you. Now what's He doing? Washing your feet off with the water of the Word and presenting you to Himself as a glorious church. You've already been presented to the husband. You are already the bride. You're not being made glorious. You are glorious. The church of Jesus Christ is a glorious church without spot and wrinkle. You go, what's all these spots and wrinkles? No, those are the actions of people on the earth. Those are not spots and wrinkles on your righteousness. They are not spots and wrinkles on the finished work. They are simply what you're doing in this earth in your humanity. They do not represent who you are as part of the body of Christ, because the body of Christ is glorious and without spot and without wrinkle and has already been presented to Jesus. He's not waiting to present. If He's waiting to present, He's not your husband. But if He's your husband and you're the bride, then you're a step away from realizing that you're a byproduct of who He is. So if you're also the bride, you're also a son. You're also a daughter. Then you can not only call Him husband, you can call Him Father. That's the relational love of who He is. For no one, husbands ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. I already commented on that one. Guys, we're in trouble. Jesus isn't in trouble, though. He loves His church so much that when the cup was presented to Him, He drank it, knowing it was going to cost Him His life. Greater love hath no man than this. He laid down His life for His friends. Incredible. For we are members of His body, of His flesh, of His bones. Verse 31. This is Genesis 2:24. Here is Paul taking our Genesis text and bringing it back into the New Covenant Church. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and his mother and join to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. That's why I told you in Genesis 2:24, God gave you the beginning and the end inside of two chapters. The beginning is I created the earth. The end is one flesh. How does Paul interpret the marriage that Jesus has with his church? He goes all the way back to the garden, to the marriage of Adam and Eve, and he says God's end game was to put a new Adam on the earth and wed him with a new Eve so that they were one flesh. What Jesus has done is he has brought his body in to who he is, so that we're one flesh on the earth. You're still an individual. Individuals fail. That's why you have spots. Those are your individual issues. The body is Christ. No spot. No wrinkle. No error. No sin. No failure. Because the body belongs to him. 32. This is a great mystery. Up until that moment, it had been a great mystery. This is hard to buy. This is tough. Because we get this. We get it now, that we're made one flesh and that it's in Christ. Paul says it's been a great mystery. Up until this moment, Israel had read Genesis 2:24 and couldn't figure out how a man and a woman getting married was one flesh. They weren't one flesh. They were two people. Right? I mean, even us. Mark and Valerie are married. But they're not one. I look at them. They're two people. That's two flesh. So what's Genesis 2:24 mean? One flesh. Paul said it's a great mystery. We've never really understood what this means, Paul says. We've never really got it. We don't really get what does he mean they become one flesh? It's a great mystery. But you know what it always meant? Christ and his church. What it always meant was, how does he pitch this as Christ? Because Paul saw Jesus as the last Adam. He saw Jesus as having produced a church from his side. He saw Jesus as willingly bringing that church back into himself and washing her off and petting her and loving her more than he loved his own body and caring for her and presenting her to himself as a glorious church without spot and without wrinkle. And Paul says, I've got the answer to Genesis 2:24. How can a man and a woman become one flesh? They really can't in the natural. They really can't. They're still two people. But it was never about you. That's what Paul says. It was never about you. It was always Christ and his church. It was always last Adam and his new Eve. It was always about him loving you more than he loved himself. It was always about bringing you in and making you one flesh, making you apart. Nevertheless, let each one of you in particular so love his own wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. This 33 rarely gets talked about. Nevertheless, you should still love and respect. Paul's whole marriage seminar is one verse long. The rest of that stuff was about Jesus. This one's about you. His whole marriage seminar is nevertheless. You don't introduce a principle with nevertheless, because what that means is, in spite of the fact that you can't do any of the other things, at least shoot for this. Here's what you shoot for. Now, why does he put nevertheless? Because he just introduced to the Ephesus church what I'm trying failingly to introduce to you. The last Adam is Jesus. And the last man on the earth is the body of Christ. That's Paul's message. And it was a mystery. And the union of you and Christ on the earth is a glorious union. Amen. Without spot, without wrinkle. And Paul goes, nevertheless, in regards to your own marriage, love your wife the way you love yourself, and women, respect your husband. That's all he's got. That's it. I mean, that's his whole marriage seminar. He goes, just do your best. And you know what we've found? What we've all found is that's all we do have. Like men, if you know, there's love and reverence, there's love and respect. When that goes both ways, marriage works. When it doesn't go both ways, marriage doesn't work. It's as simple as that. Now, it's more complex than that, but it's simplified down to that. There's love and respect. There's respect enough to be honest. There's respect enough to be truthful. There's respect enough to keep the boundaries of your covenant and to articulate truth and to love more than you love yourself and to care for other people's needs. And when we do those things, what happens? Our marriages are successful. The rest of the illustrated sermon is all about who he is. It's all about the flesh that he is building, what he is doing. I want to end with one of Grace's most famous verses. You know it so well, you probably don't have to go there. 2 Corinthians 5:17, because I want to show you where we end up. Because this is where we're heading. Everybody has this memorized. 2 Corinthians 5:17, if anyone is in Christ, he is a what?
New creation.
Why is he a new creation? Because what God has done in Jesus is he started over. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and it was made flesh. And you have been brought into union with him. And what does that mean? You're a new creation. You are a new example of God on the earth. But where does it happen? In Christ. If any man be in Christ, that's where he's a new creation. If you're in Christ, you're a new creation. Old things are passed away. All have become new. Does that mean you stop acting the way you used to act? Not automatically. And maybe never. Let's be honest. I don't tell the Holy Spirit what to do to people. And I don't complain at how fast or slow he is. If you lose patience with the Holy Spirit changing people, you'll put law on them. They won't perform up to the standard you think they ought to, and you'll give them a list of instructions so that you feel better about their salvation. Most of the law that we put on people is for our benefit, not theirs. We're just offended by how slow they're changing. When you go into a church and they're putting a list of performances on you, it's because the pastor's offended with the slow pace of the Holy Spirit. His offense is not your sin. His offense is the Holy Ghost. And so to keep himself looking good in the community, because nobody wants to pastor a church full of heathens. Put a bunch of rules and regulations on them so at least when they go out, they don't act like a bunch of maniacs. And so I look pretty good in here because lives are being changed. The reality is that attitudes are being affected and people's actions are being changed, but people's hearts aren't doing much of anything. In fact, we're taking steps backwards because we get put back under a list of performances, rules, and regulations, and we forget how righteous we are. And we drink that poison long enough, there's nothing left except backsliding and giving up on God. And that's what's happening. And the body, the path of the church is littered with the bones of people who came in through grace and left exhausted by performance because I just can't do that. There's just no way I can make it happen. So I don't tell the Holy Spirit how to change people. I don't tell people that all their old stuff immediately stops happening. But I do tell them that the old them is dead instantly. Old things are passed away. The old you is dead. Now, semblances of that old man, there's a lot of habits in your body, so there's a lot of junk you do that's beneath your standing and beneath your stature. And what you need reminded of is not what you need to do to change. You need reminded of who you are in Christ so that the Holy Spirit can go to work doing what he does. And then you don't need me to interfere by getting you to fake it till you make it. So there ain't no need for me to come in and give you a bunch of lists to fake it. Just allow the Holy Spirit to do what he does. This is why if you're going to be a church that loves people, you're going to have to love people where they are. And where they are, and sometimes going to be going completely opposite of where you are. And it's also going to be a whole trail you don't think they ought to be on at all. And it's loving them where they are and allowing the Holy Spirit to do the work that the Holy Spirit does. You say, well, how should we react when people do this or that? There are things that infect or hurt the church. Paul dealt with some of those in ways that are worth us wrestling over. But the reality is that we need to be telling people that they are not who they used to be. They're in union with who he is. Their old has passed and all has become new. Every one of us in him. What happens in Christ stays in Christ. I lived in California for a few years. My son played high school baseball in Southern California. We probably made 2 or 3 trips to Vegas every year to play baseball. It was about a 4.5-hour drive from our house. And Vegas's theme, of course, is what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. That's kind of a cover for a lot of foolishness, right? Like, you can get by with doing whatever you want, just don't go home and tell anybody. I just thought that was a stupid thing. What happens there stays there. What happens never stays anywhere. Because wherever you go, it goes. We all know that. But that reminds me, what's in Christ stays in Christ. There's nothing. We're a body. We're in him. The work of sealing us together is his work. Let's allow him to do that work. One flesh, God's object on the earth was to bring one flesh, and its body is represented as the church, and the head is still Jesus. We are the one flesh on the earth that the story tells us about in the Bible. Leave today encouraged. That's what I hope you leave. Leave encouraged. My old man is gone. My new man is alive. The slow pace of change I see is not a problem. The Holy Spirit is not offended. I'm in the one man on the earth. I don't have to worry about being kicked out of the one man on the earth. I want to know who I am in Christ. I have my feet washed off. I am what the Bible says I am. I am who the Bible says that I am. I'm not who I used to be. I am a new creature. I'm in Christ, and whatever's in Christ is a new creation, and I'm part of that new creation on the earth. I'm not the problem. I'm a solution to the problem. The answer is in who He is, and I am in who He is. Father, thank You today for this word. Thank You for Your help in this word. Any area, Father, where we interjected and did not shine the light on Jesus, cause crop failure for that, Lord. Just choke that out. But wherever the lamp was shining brightly on Your Son, wherever Jesus was glorified, wherever the love of the Father was made to be clear and not cloudy, in those areas, Lord, amplify the sound of those words today in the hearts of Your people. Let that be the line they remember from this message. Whatever line it was that made Jesus look glorious and good, whatever line that it was that picked Him up and lifted Him up above all things, may that be what we walk away with. Put that word in our heart. May we know that we are a part of the body, and that the body has... There's nothing that can happen to destroy that last Adam on the earth. He's already conquered death, hell, and the grave. And that we're secure in Him. And we thank You and we praise You in Jesus' name. And if you believe it today, say amen.
Amen.
God bless you, church. We love you.